What's up, everybody? Welcome, welcome, welcome. Hope you're all doing good. Today I'm going to be profiling not just profiling, but increasing load speed between areas. So I've noticed this recently where you go from one area to another and it slows down a lot. So I would show you guys right now, but I'm in this state of the game where it's running this debug state where it just loads as many areas as it can. It just loads an area, unloads the area, loads the next one, unloads the next one. What up, Arcane? And then it just keeps doing that, doing that, doing that, so it can establish a good profile. So I've already identified the huge areas that could be improved. So over 10 seconds, just 10 seconds of constantly loading areas. Each area takes like about 250 milliseconds or so. I think, yeah, delete, well, 500 total. So it's actually taking 180 around to delete the old area and then 220 for the creating the new area. And both of those have huge bottlenecks. One of them for creating areas is taking out of the whole 10 seconds, 2.5 entire seconds. That's like 25% of the time is spent just creating the ground texture. And actually just creating the purlin noise for the ground texture. So there's a huge area I can improve there. That might be 25% of the load time right there. And then the next one is this. The remove all children whenever I draw the map. So every time it releases the old area, it draws the map because it pings the HUD. And basically the draw map is incredibly performs bad because of it's removing all the children for the map every time. So I'm good, Arcane. How are you doing? I'm just kind of getting over my cold. I might be kind of coughing still on the stream, but I'm feeling a lot better. Things are going great. Yesterday I added some cool ripples. Maybe I'll show you guys later on after I get this all fixed up. I think I'm going to start with the removing all children thing because this affects every single area in the whole game. The purlin noise only affects areas that use the ground texture, which is like the overworld and caves. So this one right here, which is about 20% of all the load time, is just here and remove all children. So this could be a huge boon. This is the quickest, lowest hanging fruit right here. Thanks for hosting, Power Up Audio. Okay, so let's start off with it. I guess we need to figure out a way to make it so when you ping the HUD, it doesn't actually ping the HUD until the next time it draws the HUD. I think that's the way to do it. So let's go to where it pings the HUD. Let's make this like a little bit. I might want to do this eventually. Procrastinating, why is that? I think procrastination is an important skill. So ping HUD just goes right in and redraws the map right away. But game scene already has its own animate, I believe. Where it, yeah, all it does is animate loops, and I believe tick. Yeah, Tick only animates the game scene if you're actually playing. This is good. This will really improve performance. You should be working on your dissertation. Good, man. Good. Are you what? Where are you at with your dissertation? Do you have like the overall concept? Maybe you're procrastinating for a good reason. Maybe you're building up your thoughts, your subconscious thoughts first. Okay, so what I'm going to do is that whenever the game calls ping HUD, it'll set a flag and be like, all right, I need you to ping the HUD next time it animates the game scene. So that's what it'll do. So the game scene needs a variable. Let's do a static variable so we don't have to define it in the header. You haven't started yet? Right on. You got this. We'll do a quick little enum type for this too. Wait, maybe I should have a delay too. Like it has a delay and a. No, tick's already, yeah. The tick already handles that pretty well with the delay. Because when you slow down time with the tick, it will actually slow that down too. Thanks for hosting, Dieharders So, ping none. Ping. Ping no fade out and ping fade out. We'll do a static ping HUD. We'll call this HUD ping. Yay! Is ping none. There. So now we've got a variable we can track what needs to be done with the HUD. You have to do some coding. Oh yeah, that's right. You're doing it about the maps. Oh, okay. So you got some prep work to do. I hear you. So the actual ping HUD method. What? Teeks, what's up? How you doing today? So HUD ping equals do fade out. Ping fade out. Ping no fade out. There. So it just schedules the action. We'll do a static void. We'll call this one do ping HUD. Yeah, smaller chunks, totally. Open the files, navigate, find your entity, get the location. Nice. So do fade out equals HUD ping equals ping fade out. Oops, this is supposed to be a const bool. Oh, not a const bool. Oh, this needs to be an actual method of game scene. It's using map layer. Okay, so I guess this will be called ping HUD now. Can I make a private method here? What is this? Oh, yeah. This is going to be private. All right, we'll make a private method. Ping HUD now. What's up, Bear on Fire? It's going well, man. There's no approximate release date yet, but check back real soon. I use an engine called Cocos 2DX. How are you doing today? Welcome to the stream. Okay, so we got a ping HUD now. Boy, game scene. Ping HUD now. Now, if it's just ping HUD, if the ping HUD value is none, then it just returns. You doing great? Oh, sweet. LWJ. That's a JavaScript one, right? Sweet, it's gonna be 3D. Dude, nice, Teak. Yeah, apprenticeship. That's so great. What's up, Pedro? It's 420. What time is it here? It was 420 for me earlier. If you know what I mean. Oh, it's only 3 o'clock here. I got like an hour and 20 minutes. Right on. Yay. So I'm just doing programming today. I'm profiling and improving the load speed between areas. So in a moment, we'll be able to test this. So now I've got a method that's called ping HUD now, which actually does the work of pinging the HUD. So the HUD won't actually ping itself until it's ticked via animate. So in the animate method, we always just call game scene ping HUD now. And that handles everything. It pings the HUD if it needs to. So after it's gotten its HUD ping type, it can reset ping HUD to be ping HUD none. Ah, I just realized this is gonna be a lot of work still. Like the draw map is a really inefficient method because of removing all of the children that it created for drawing the map. So it's almost like it should reuse its sprites. That would be a lot smarter for the map. Right. Wow, it's Vulcan too? That's nice. All right, so the only thing is I wish I would have made it all those variable names. I always do my constants and stuff. Wait. Oh, not game. Game scene. Okay, good. Now I've got everything segmented into some different, those different things. Like it could trigger the fact that it needed to load or ping the HUD many times per, Oh, this is HUD ping. So yeah, basically, if the game like is loading and it's loading a new area, and maybe there's like two or three different places that call ping HUD, it's not going to go and unload the entire map, redraw the entire map, creating all those sprites every time it calls ping HUD. Because all it's doing now is just setting a variable, and then the next time it actually animates the game scene, that's when it actually does the work of pinging the HUD. So let's see, first of all, if it runs in the regular game. That's what we should do first. So let's turn off profile areas, so it's not trying to load as many areas as it can. It's just going to actually play the game. And we'll make sure that it's actually still working, like the ping of the HUD and everything just still works. Okay, so it looks like it's still doing the profile. Yeah, it's still the profile. Why would that be? Oh. There we go. So we just gotta load the setting correctly. That would be good. So now it's actually reading the zero value instead of just checking if there is a value. And these only compile in debug mode. All right, so we got the HUD. What if we go to a new area? We'll go downstairs. Nice, it faded out. Faded back in as it's meant to. Oh. Computer doesn't like to run. The game is 60 while I'm streaming. So everything's still good. It's drawing the map. It might even be smoother right now. I'm not sure how much time was spent loading areas there. Okay, so now let's go back and debug it. This time, we'll see if the time improved since last time. So basically, I'm gonna run it again, profile it, and then look at the delete entities thing here. Before you can see that out of 10 whole seconds, it took 3 seconds to delete its entities, and 2 of those whole seconds were all just removing children because of drawing the map, because of pinging the HUD and all that. Which, now that I'm thinking about it, this is actually taking so much time because it's calling set item image multiple times. So this is a huge thing, just setting one single variable so it actually does it when it needs to. Hopefully, let's cross our fingers. Hopefully this just 2 seconds just magically goes away. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. Oh, there. Okay, so we need to select 10 seconds. Man, purling noise is huge. We'll get to that. Draw a map. Yes, look at that. Compared to last time, already a huge improvement. Last time, draw map was taking up 3 seconds, was it? Draw map, well, draw map was taking 2 seconds. Delete entities was taking 3 seconds. Where's draw or delete entities? Oh, this is a different draw map. Yeah, look at that. Delete entities. It's so low on the list now. It's only 680 milliseconds. That's great. This is significant. No, draw map before was... Draw map before was... 2 milliseconds. This is 2 seconds. 1,000 times 2 milliseconds. Yeah. Gosh, this is great. All right. We've already killed one bug here. I mean, let's check this in so far. This is great. Or not a bug, but that's a significant performance improvement. I think I'll check that in. Game scene and game scene.cpp separately. Yeah. Oh, one more improvement. Shoot, while I was just checking that in, I was like, wait a minute. What if when you're when you unping the HUD, you should also What does ping HUD do? It basically just redraws the HUD. So like if the area has changed. Actually, no, all the time you ever do it, it redraws the entire map, which is the biggest performance hit because the map, the little mini map, has so many little sprites in there. And then it redraws everything else, like the it'll redraw your equipment, how much courage you have, and all that. It just basically refreshes the HUD and also makes it fade in and out and things like that. See, is unping HUD even being called? Oh, wait, before I do this, I should check in the other code too. This is pretty good too. Oh, yeah. What would you name something like that? I'm curious. It's fun to see how we name things and like how we approach certain problems, you know? Sometimes we have really different solutions to everything, but we, you know, we can get things done anyways. Okay, so this is the function basically that loads an area continually. Good. Good. Okay, so now the unping part. Is it actually calling unping HUD, I wonder? Oh, yeah, here. It's only taking 1 millisecond though. So maybe this is not at all a performance hit. Maybe I shouldn't even worry about this. Is there anywhere else that calls unping HUD? Okay, at the very least, unping HUD should call, should reset the HUD ping variable. Oh, actually, I got a better idea. Unping node could do the same thing. Like, it could do all its work inside the ping HUD thing. That's a good idea. Unping HUD. Let's make that. So we'll have another ping HUD type called ping HUD or ping unping. And then we'll just move this unping HUD code into ping HUD now. Okay, so now we've got it. So the HUD ping variable has another setting where you can where it can unping. And so where it's actually doing the animation work, it goes and does an unping. So once again, if unping just gets called constantly, like maybe 10 or 20 times before the actual animation updates, it won't actually go and do all this work for unloading children and unpinging the node. It will do all the work just once. All right, so we've got profile area set to 0. I just want to make sure the game still does everything like it did fine. Okay, so the HUD appears to be working just fine. Let's pay attention to it. I was like, yeah, it's working just fine. Let's make sure that it did actually trigger this at least once when I did that. Yeah, it's doing it right away. Where is this getting called from? Tick anime, tick update. Let's see if it gets called again. Right. Just got unpinged once. So I think going downstairs should trigger another unping. Yeah. But only once. Good. Oh my god, just for reference, let's go when it actually unpings the HUD. Let's do these two up here. Yeah, let's set a breakpoint when it actually unpings the HUD. So we can see how many times it actually was doing that. Okay, so we got it called once. Okay, only once that time. Once from on begin. Okay, it really wasn't that big of a deal, but still it's a better system. Let's check that in. Okay, now I'm going to go back to profiling the areas and make this next change about focusing on the purlin noise, which is another huge part of it. Okay, I'm going to do one more profiling session before that though, just to see where we're at now. I'm going to take a little screenshot so we can track the difference. Three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. I can hear rain. It was a rainy area. 10 seconds worth of time. Animate only taking 1 second, good, 1 millisecond. That's great. Okay, wait, this time out of 10 seconds, we're only using 8.93. Already it's more efficient. Layer system tick area. Creating areas is taking 8.25 seconds, but deleting entities, this is the huge part right here. System int destroy now is the only thing taking any time. Gear, oh my god, this is so much more efficient. This was used to take. Auto unequip, delete entities took 3 seconds. Auto unequip item used to take 2 whole seconds. That's right. Now it's taking 1 millisecond. Of course, because it's delaying all its work till it doesn't even need to do it. Oh, wait a minute, just looking at the actual areas. Oh, this is more efficient too. Of course it is, because it's not even calling, it's on ping or whatever. Okay, there's definitely some stuff. Once I actually finish all this work, I'll need to go back and profile it with it actually just playing the game, because there's some stuff I can do to improve the performance of drawing the map. I know, Perlin noise. That's going to be huge. That's like most of the 300 milliseconds right there is Perlin noise. This is per area. So this used to take almost a whole half second to load a new area. That's really, really slow. Okay, so we could take a screenshot here. Int destroy now, is there anything that could be done to make that better? This is all removing components. Oh, if I made my whole system, my entity component system better, I could actually reuse render components. That's something for a later date though. So this 680 milliseconds right here actually could mostly be optimized away. But I'm gonna take a screenshot. We call this after one. And good, we're now ready for the next thing, Perlin noise. Let's take a look at that again. It's mostly here in this create dirt one. So it's creating the ground texture for the dirt. And it's generating some Perlin noise for that. What's up, Rocket? And there's two big things I could do to improve this performance. One is to make the actual Perlin noise generator faster. But two, maybe more importantly, is to generate the Perlin noise before. So it doesn't need to do this Perlin noise generate every time. This is totally non-critical to the game. This is just seriously, all it is doing is adding some little circles to the ground texture. So it's really not that important. Voice of Grog, what's up? What's up, you guys? In fact, that'd be a good thing to try first. Before it does anything, we'll just turn off the Perlin noise. Right. Splotch terrain, generate. Oh, because it's generating a whole 420 by 240, six color levels deep each time it creates an area. And is this the only? Yeah, this is the only Perlin noise. All right. So to turn off Perlin noise, all we would need to do is turn off splotches. Let's try that with data. Splotches. Okay, and this one is overworld, and the other one I think was cave. So we've disabled splotches. This should turn off all the Perlin noise. I'm gonna profile once again and see approximately how much room there is to improve. One, 1,000, two, three, four. Okay, so like 10 seconds. Really? Nice. Right on. Is it 420? It's not March 20th. Is it? It's still February. Is it 420 for you? Big Mac Dev, best part of programming. It is really rewarding, isn't it? It gets me excited every time I'm like, oh my god, I just saved 2 whole seconds out of 10 seconds right there. Oh, did I save 420? Oh, the resolution 420. 420 by 240. Now you know why I chose that number, huh? But it also works out really well. 420, 240, 840, 480. It's just like a really, really nice even ratio. I know we're in the same time zone. I don't even know what time it is now, Rocket Bunny. I don't even know. If you've ever noticed, I don't have a clock. I don't appreciate knowing what time it is all the time. But now I'm curious. What time is it? Oh, it's 3:20. We got a whole hour, man. We got a whole hour till our 4:20. Oh, yeah. Optimizing web pages is a huge thing, right? Right? Isn't that cool? Such a great feeling. Okay, so without Perlin noise, layer system, area update, create area, still taking 8 seconds? No. It's still taking a long time with the dirt. Maybe it's still creating the dirt. It's still generating Perlin noise. I just disabled it. That's weird. Maybe it didn't work. I guess let's throw this around it. If zero, that should have been... How did that not work? Maybe it didn't copy the file or something. Oh, okay. I'm gonna do this profile again. Cause it didn't not do it. It still did the Perlin noise. All I'm trying to determine is how much performance could be improved by not doing Perlin noise at all. How much room for improvement? 3, 4. Forgot to record. Damn it. Profile. Wow, it's still generating Perlin noise. I must not understand what's going on. That's a good question. Okay, Perlin noise is still being generated even though I wrapped the code in if zero, which means it must be creating some Perlin noise elsewhere. World terrain, maybe? Oh, there's the terrain as well as the splotch terrain. Oh, it must be that. It must be the actual terrain. Oh, and here it is. It's generating the terrain. Derp. Yeah, it's Perlin. Perlin with an N. Perlin noise. And here's where it's actually generating. Okay, now I need to make it so the Perlin noise is smart enough. Already is smart enough. Nice. If you try and get something beyond its indexes or if it hasn't been generated, then it should be okay. So we should be able to just delay, just disable all this. We get rid of these if zeros because they're not being used either. And the splotch terrain, man. There's two different terrains being generated here, but I think both of them are huge. They're both 420 by 240, which seems kind of wasteful. All right, we'll turn that off then. I guess we should make sure it still actually runs. We're crashing already, which is good. Can fix these little crashes. Get terrain. Oh, this get terrain method is not safe. HD, what's up? How you doing, man? Good. This time it's working. All right, so and let's see how much. How much did that actually? Yeah, that improved a lot. So it took the new area creation down from like 320 to like 160 milliseconds. Nice. Relaxing, taking in the sights. Nice. What's up, Space Bunny? Okay, so that can improve the performance of loading the areas. Loading the new area by 160 milliseconds at least. So okay, so total time before was about 178 plus like 323 or so. It was about 500 milliseconds. And now, without any Perlin noise at all, it's 37 plus 175, or about two. We've definitely improved the performance of loading new areas by 200% already. But without, I guess I gotta fix this actual Perlin noise part. So there's the potential for another 25% improvement or whatever. Yeah. Okay, now how to actually make that happen? Oh, at the very least. Okay, good. This is pretty smart. The terrain only generates itself once. Oh, that explains why when you go to an area for the first time, it takes longer because it's generating this terrain. How big is the, it would be nice if we How big is the world's terrain? The world generates some purlin noise already. Maybe the world should generate one big purlin noise. That would be a good way to do it. And then each area could take a small slice of that purlin noise. I'm gonna think about that. Be right back. Yeah, exactly, Rugged. What's up, Dan Rocks? Bob Freeze on break. I think he broke a little bit. He might be broken right now. Something with Twitch's API changed or something. Don't know. Okay, I'm pretty sure the world generates this noise. It's more. I think it generates one pixel per tile or something like that. There it is, world terrain generate. So I'm gonna go over to the world terrain. Yeah, here it is. So it's number of areas and then the area width. Yeah. Oh, they changed it again? Twitch is changing things too much. Yeah, T. Purling noise takes a while to generate, though. It's already takes a while to. Why does it take so long to generate purling noise? If this whole algorithm were more efficient, if there's some way I could, like. I know I've looked at this before, though. I guess it's using. Wait, we're using data.pushback? Or we've reserved data, though. Huh, wait. So the biggest part of generating Perlin noise is in the get noise function, not even the generate terrain function. Get noise, because we're calling grad, lerp, and fade. Yeah. Hey, thanks for auto-hosting. Catch a neck. So, I guess it's worth it to check out the get noise function real quick to see if there's some obvious optimization to be done. There totally is. It's using a vector. Is it a vector? Yeah, this should be true. I want to at least try writing this without that. Let's turn back on splotches. Yeah, so it's using a vector, which is going to be slightly slower to access its data than a C array. It's not significant, but it might affect a lot of a performance here. So I'm going to try that first. I'm going to make data a pointer to data type. And maybe they don't need to be doubles. Oh, wait, it already is float data type. Okay, so this is going to be a data type pointer. This is going to be an unsigned car pointer. And let's proceed to make this more efficient. I'm thinking maybe even working with integers might be faster for all this. I wonder if it's possible to use integers. I guess you would just use the floating point times 255 or something. Huh. We'll save that. I'm gonna think about that. Maybe I'll switch this to data float type int, but it'll require some work to change the way it. I don't know. All right, so back to get or extensions.cpp, and this whole class needs to be rethought how it stores its data. Wow, that's a good question, Segtooth. So the first thing it needs to do when it's generating it should re-clear itself in case it's accidentally generating twice. And then data equals new width times height plus one. Whoa. Just deleted the whole function. Guess you can't. Can I change two? Left bracket? There we go. Data new data size. Wait, am I doing this right? It's been a minute. Data is data type. Is that right? Yeah. No, not right. I forgot how to do the new. Reference selector? What do you mean? Where's a class where I do this blocks? Oh, that's it. Right. The brackets come after. Man, I've been programming for 20 years. I just forgot how to do a C++. New with an array. That's funny. So that's terrain. Oh, terrain is a uint8t. This is unsigned y, x. This should no longer be data pushback. This should be data y times height plus x equals c. And we're going to need to access the other guys like this too. Everywhere else where we're accessing data, it'll be data y times height. No. Yeah. No? Y times width. Duh. Y times the width plus x. Yeah. We're accessing a one-dimensional array with two dimensions, basically. Okay, what's next? Normalize takes C. Oh, we already have it appropriate for that. Data Y times width plus X. That works. Generate terrain. Maybe generate terrain is the same. You know, it uses this get. Oh, and here's terrain.pushback. This should be terrain. Wait, we're pushing back in. Oh, we've got X and Y though. So y times width plus x equals n. All right, and then if terrain is null, we haven't generated anything, just return. Yeah. I'll say mod terrain size. Oh, this is going to be data size. Whoops. So this is data size, which is just width times height. And this should be checked too. If width is 0 or height is 0, we can't do this method. Actually, we just need to check data. Data is not equal to null. And X is less than width. And Y is less than height. That should make that safe. And then we don't really need to do this. There we go, that's simplified. Now this getNoise function, we'll need to take a look at that too. But that should improve the performance of this class a bit. So how can I measure this exactly how I did with this right here? We're using Perlin noise, get noise, generate. Did I take a screenshot of this one? It is. All right, good. Welcome to the stream, PX. The last one I did was delete entities. So we need to take a screenshot of this one. This is with... I think this is with, oh man, I forgot how which wish I how I did this one, but oh well. We'll just call this one after two. We'll know if this improved the performance. It should be noticeable. Okay, let's compile. Perlin noise. So I made the Perlin noise class. The Perlin noise is a huge bottleneck with the performance for loading areas. And I'm trying to improve the class first, just to see if there's a few things to do. Because without, if I change the way the class actually works, like, I mean, the way, how much terrain it generates, or like the numbers it's using to generate the terrain, then the whole game is actually gonna change a little bit, you know, visually. So I'm trying to do it without changing stuff too much, just improve the performance without actually changing the programming, you know what I mean? Oh, we got a profile, not run normal. Oh, wait. Ew, we got to start with null. Yeah, a lot of time. A lot of time. So I started off the stream, I was sharing how much performance the room there is. And out of 10 seconds, I basically set up a test where it loads areas constantly. It's just loading area, 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 going through the entire overworld, loading the areas, never even showing them. It's just, see, it's just a black screen right here, but it's actually loading the screens in the background. And so it's just nothing but load time. And then I'm profiling all that to see where is the actual, you know, where are the bottlenecks? And it didn't profile again that time. It's weird. Is this beer? What? There, now it's profiling. All right, let's run. One, two, three, four. That's about 10 seconds. Okay, so I'm selecting 10 seconds of time. This thing never works. Well, we can always just click our way down to it. Click, click, click. So we're using 9.7 seconds total. We're still, this is still going to be a lot of time spent with the purling noise. I don't think it's really improved performance much at all, actually. I guess it did a little. Not really that much, so. So great. Dirt one ground, ground texture. Oh, it did. Wait a minute. Now the purling noise is only taking 1.18 seconds, as opposed to what it did before, which was 2 seconds, I believe, wasn't it? The last one? The last one, purling noise generate. 2.85 seconds. Now it's down to 1.18 seconds. That's really good. And did that actually, do we see that reflected? And we do. That's awesome. Yes. That's really good. Actually, this is really, really good because before, without generating any purling noise, we had it down to 160. And now we're seeing it like this one's 182, this one's 240, 200. Before, this was about 320 or more per area. This one's only 168. This one's a whole 364, though. I wonder why. Wow, that was actually significant. Holy crap. Okay, well, the next thing to do, let's take a screenshot and then make sure the game's still is generating terrain as it used to. Like everything looks the same. So I need to turn off profile areas and make sure I haven't changed or the code. Oh, never mind. I wasn't even generating terrain. We got to redo this test and throw away this result. Dope. So I gotta check out area.cpp. Before I do the next test, I should make sure this is just some atomic commit. Yep, data size, terrain. Dang, I was kind of excited about that result, but it's going to be nothing like that. Oh, actually, did I delete? What did I delete after 3? Let's take that one back. Keep that. So that's our now. That's now the example of what we could eventually do. After 3 could become. Wait, but why is purling noise still taking time? I guess because of splotches. Okay, one more profile. Hopefully it's just a little faster than it was. Oh. six, seven, still taking a long time. 2.92 seconds. Xcode. This is instruments. It's kind of Xcode. Okay, so we didn't really improve that performance that much. Vim! Don't worry, I'm still using Vim. I'm gonna call this one after possible. That's if, actually no, we don't need that one. So if anything, it made it slower, but that can't be right. It's just about the same as it was, 2.85 to 2.92. This is exactly almost the same. So I'm gonna check it in because I believe it's faster. It has the potential to be faster, I'm sure it does. Using a plain old C array for just accessing things in a plain old C array kind of way. Okay, so now there's one more thing I could try, and that's when it generates its Perlin noise. It could use uint8 type for its data. Vim's for grown-ups. What are the toddlers get to use then? What are the kids? What do all the tykes get to use? Why can't I use Vim, Dad? Oh, just making sure that this does still load. Sublime? Oh, that's what everybody else gets to use? Sublime? We have to use Sublime, Dad! Why? Okay, good. So this is what the Perlin noise is actually generating, is this terrain stuff right here. So you see how this is having little bits of terrain on the ground? That's what's taking so much time to load these areas. Stencil? Stencil? What? What? Stencil what? Okay, next, one more experiment is to try Perlin noise with a different data type. Let's do this. Extensions dot. Extensions.h. MC edit, yeah! Wait, what is stencil? I thought stencil was a drawing thing or like a I don't know what it is. Let's try UN8 type. Instead of floats. I am Wibbly. No, purlin noise is not entirely necessary to have that effect. But it is if I want to have those little loopy things on the ground. Those do require purlin noise to generate, to make them look like that. It actually generates a background texture there for all of it. Actually, no, I should do regular. Wait, if I just set the data type to UN8, maybe we'll see if the performance actually improves before I try and rechange the whole class to work with it. Oh, it's an engine editor. Yeah, that's right. Stencil. The kids have to use Stencil. Hi, everybody. I'm really starting to get interested in talking coding. Like, there's some videos out there of people coding with... this one guy did it where he codes entirely... He codes mostly with Python, but he codes entirely by voice. And he's got drag and dictate all set up and everything. Now that Vim is like something I know how to use, I can easily start working with just my voice. Like I could actually code by voice. That would be really neat. Yes, you can use Construct too, as long as you wash your hands and brush your teeth before bed. I want to use Construct 2 as well. I need to graduate from the kids table. Apparently it works with the UN8 type, at least compiles. Oh, Space Monam, you saw that? The one I watched worked pretty well. It was this one guy, he was coding by voice with Python. And I think Dragon Dictate has gotten better because now there's a Dragon Dictate for Mac at least. That was like 4 years ago. Okay. Everything compiled fine, so let's see if it actually improves the performance to use a UN8 instead of a float. Oh, you can't progress, you're stuck. Well, the new update's coming out and it'll change everything anyways. So okay, this should be ready to go. All right, let's profile it. Whoops. Oh, it just quit right away. Some bug in it.
Hello everyone, my name is Anton, and today we are going to attempt...
Oh yeah, this is not the video I saw. I'll check this out.
...in Java.
Is it funny?
...using only the Windows Speech Recognition software.
It's priceless. So, gotta check it out. No, it'll never reset your progress. No. It'll never reset your progress. I'm just saying that the layout of the world, the locations of the dungeons, and the layout of the dungeons, and the layout of the overworld will change. in the next update, which is probably going to be Wednesday. How did S become zero here? Oh, this shouldn't be data type. Okay, this needs to step differently. Perlin noise step, this is not going to work the same. Let's just say that's one for now. Tyrio! Really? I gotta check it out. Yeah, the one I saw is actually, he's actually really efficient. He works with Emacs. He uses Python and Dragon Dictate, and he can code. He can seriously code, and fast too. He's got his own language, just like lerp, derp, snurp, slap, whack. I'm not sure if this is much faster or not. Let's see. Maybe it is. Let's check this out. Profile that. Oh, what? It took longer? Okay, so that made it worse. It definitely made it worse to use integers. Okay, well, let's go backwards and let's go with the more meta solution of like generating Perlin noise only once per world. That would be, it might be possible. Okay, so while that's recompiling, we need to come up with a better solution. So right now it generates it's generating a 420 by 240 for each area, sometimes even twice. That's 420 times 240. It's generating 100,000 different Perlin noises or whatever per. There's no way this could be optimized. I guess this is why it takes so long, because it's using functions like this, lerp. Oh. Oh, this could be faster if it. Oh, wow, it is accessing RANs a lot, huh? Yeah, I already made this a plain old array though. Okay, it is, so it accesses RANs like a ton. And each one of the, oh, this is why this takes so long, is because it's loading so many of. Calling so many functions here, like lerp and fade, all these could be. Pound defines. All right, man. See you, Ishni. But there's the more meta solution. Yeah, I think I'm gonna try this. This is like, this might be worth it. Okay, so these methods here, fade, lerp, grad, and step. I want them to have pound define equivalents. So what I'm doing here is I'm actually I'm just making pound-defined versions of these functions, so there's no function call overhead, which it seems like there might be a ton of function call overhead every time you're calling get noise here. It's just calling a bajillion little functions, always pushing back stacks and all that. It's a lot of work. Unfortunately, the grad function requires setting some variables, though. It is used quite a lot. Grad, 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 grad. There's got to be a way to simplify this. Oh, yeah, there definitely is. It's going to be kind of wordy, but this will work. We'll just replace everything here. Is going to become H. What's up, Killing Begin? I'm optimizing some Perlin noise. Oh, this can be, oh, this is totally, this can be simplified. So U is just that. So we take this times that. Oh, but H. We got to change this out to H as well. Okay, so then V is a lot more complicated. It takes H a bunch of times. So that's H. If H is less than 4, we use Y. Oh my God, this could be way faster using mix as well. It's creating a ton of branches. This is branch heaven. Branch, 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 branch. It's just like This could all be mixes instead of branchings, and this could be faster as well. Okay, I hope I kept the grad function as it needs to be here. This is pretty complicated. But it should be the same exact logic. I should probably check this. So H is always hash. In fact, let's call that just H instead of hash. Make this a little shorter. H in 15 is less than 8. We use X or Y. So we're using U. H is less than 8, X or Y. And then just multiplying it by, if you have bit 1, oh, hasn't bits one. If you don't have bit one, you use times one. Otherwise, you use times minus one. That's a good simplification there. And then if H is, so V is different. If H is less than 4, we're using Y. Otherwise, we're using if H equals 12, or H equals 14, we're using X, otherwise Z. All that times one if we don't have bit 2, and minus 1 if we do. Whew. Okay, so that is now the equivalent of that. Hopefully that's correct. Now we got one more function to make better here, and that's the step function. Make this all faster. Define step. This might even be a function already somewhere. C and steps. This is really a clamp F, but I don't really want to use clamp F here. Oh, C divided by S. It's the same thing as C times steps. Wait, what? Yeah, it's just sealed. C times steps over steps. Okay, once again, not pretty, but should be equivalent. CLC times steps. So if you had a C value of like 0.54 times step 6, 0.54 times 6 is 3.24. Sealing that, you get 4. Divided by the number of steps, 6 is going to be 0.6666 instead of 0.54. Yeah, that's fine. And then if it's less than the minimum step, you use the minimum step. This could just be a min function. Once again, this could be simpler as well. But I think we're ready to try this. Change this huge statement into just using those pound defines now, and then just make sure it still is running and working and all that. Okay, so it's just gonna be lerp. Oh, that's it. There's no steps or anything here? Guess not. All right. Where do we use step in the other one then? Oh, fade. Where's fade? Salad, what's up, man? Ahoy. Here's some fades. Let's make these underscore fades. Yeah, nice. How did you have fun with that? What'd you do? And the last thing is the step function. Where is that used? Well, I guess probably only, oh, here. Here's one. Well, there we go. Now we got every one of these functions. We could just basically get rid of them if we wanted. Okay, so the first thing to do is make sure it still works. Oh, wait, what's up with that? Oh, these need to be defined higher up here. Okay, so both grad and step could still be faster by not using branches or calling functions. Seal is actually called by the step function here. Okay, let's cross your fingers that the worlds actually still look the same. Oh, I think I remember what it looked like just a minute ago. Oh, good. Yes, it's fine. We still have this little dip here and there. And remember this little dip over here too. And this guy. Actually, we could take a screenshot and just roll back. Yeah, Jib's got him. He has there's the item right now called the Jib Stash. It's been around the whole time, the whole Songbringer project. Yeah, you can get it. You can find the Jib Stash in a secret cave in every world. And that gives Jib that little mustache. Okay, I'm going to roll back one commit just to make sure that still is the same screenshot. Oh, right, the draw list. Oh yeah, that's right. Whoa, what was it? Yeah, good, we got the exact same screen. The terrain on the ground is what I'm looking at, and they are exactly the same terrains. So by writing those new pound defines, I didn't break anything with how it generates its terrain. Now we're back to master, and we can improve these performances even more. Let's see what it looks like now though. Profile areas. Using these new methods. Whoa, did I profile? Did it start the profiler here? I don't think it did that time. Profile. One, 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, 1,000, 4,000. Oh, the allocator. Oh. Man, I'm so excited for you making your own engine. Oh, did it take longer? Don't tell me it took longer. Oh, the sprite buffers. Oh, nice. Nice way to handle that. What? 3.84? Oh, let's do one more. What? Impossible. Okay, a quick way to go back and forth between these without. Messing anything up, it's just to redefine it like this. What's up, Tone? How does the weather system work with the procedural generation? It just works on each world seed gives you a starting point for the weather. So the weather starts as like rainy, or the weather starts as sunny, or the weather starts as snowy. And then every time you beat a boss in the world that you're in, it changes the weather again. So it goes from rainy to even rainier to snowy and then back to sunny. So that's kind of how it works. Oh. Oh, whoops. Ah. It's running great now. Cool. Okay, let's make sure too that maybe like game shows suddenly using like a bunch of CPU. It does this. Oh, it is. No, it's not. It's only using 60%. All right, we're okay. Let's profile one more time. Thanks, man. Whoa, 10 hours? That's pretty good. Yeah. Hopefully this returns the exact same result. 'Cause I'm pretty sure that pound define is gonna be faster, unless it really is just doing work too much there. Damn it, this time it took 2.42. Oh, I don't believe this, really? Switch back to the other one more time. The profiling is going really good. I already improved the performance of loading areas by 25%. So over like 10 seconds, I cut out 2.5 seconds already. And this other big part here is the purlin noise. So I'm working on the purlin noise, trying to make it more efficient. But probably the best thing to do here at this point, instead of trying to improve the purlin noise's class performance, is to just generate purlin noise once per world. You know, like maybe one big purlin noise per world. And it, because right now it's generating purlin noise every single area. Every time it loads an area, it generates some purlin noise so that it can generate a ground texture that looks cool. So just playing around with that. It's 2.5 seconds out of 10 seconds. So we're talking actually speeding up the loading of areas by 150 milliseconds or so far. And so it used to take 500 milliseconds to load a new area, which is a lot. If you're thinking about it, you have to wait an entire half second when you just go to the edge of the screen to get to the next area. So that's already been improved by about 150 milliseconds. So now we're down to like 300, 350. So I think this can also be improved another 150 milliseconds or so with just the purlin noise, which I'm still flabbergasted that this didn't make it faster. It's got to be wrong. One, two, three, four. Yeah, exactly. It does have a big experience. It'll totally make it smoother. Tone Loke, I cannot right now. I will in a minute, though. You're barely going to be able to notice the difference, especially watching the stream, because it's like, it's only 200 milliseconds or whatever when you load a new area, but it's significant. It's a significant feeling. You can really feel the difference. You know, you can't really see the difference that much. Holy crap! No, it's totally true. That slowed down the purlin noise generates significantly. Wow. So there's no ifs, ands, or buts here. This latest thing I just wrote made it all slower. Damn it. Those times when you think you could make it faster, I guess one more thing I could try is instead of branching. Okay, this is going to be the last thing I try today. So this is obviously a lot slower. Yeah, we'll keep it like that for now, I guess. Okay, so we're going to go with these methods. Jeez, oh no! Yes, clone geek, exactly. Okay, I think there could be some things done to improve the lerp, though. Or wait, not the lerp. The lerp and the fade are both. The grad, this grad function could be better. See how many branches this grad uses? This uses a ton of branches. I'm gonna try and write this method without using branches and see if that programming in general, for sure. Oh my God. So the hash, that's important to keep as it is. But this bit, the U, H is less than 8. It's either X or Y. This could totally be rewritten using a mix. So auto U equals mix. All right, mix F. We're going to mix together X and Y. And the alpha is going to be float. H is less than 8. That's also incurring a function call overhead, which could make it slower in a way. Yeah, I know Saladon's right. It's total feeling of foreboding. What did I? That did not just work on the first try. Okay, so we'll see what's faster, the function call overhead or this. Okay, so now we're mixing Y and hold on, mix F Y and mix F right after release. Damn it. All right, so we're mixing X or Z in this next one. And X or Z is if float H equals 12 or H equals 14. And then this next one was mixed if float H is less than 4. And then the return value. It's really your couch. Red on tone look. What? You broke the feet off crazy. So what this is working out here is just a one or a negative one. Same thing with this. Oh, this is just, okay, so we take a floating point value of, wait, I should confirm this. Float something is equal to float H less than 8. I'm pretty sure that works out. Actually, we should confirm this. Confirm! Oh, okay. It's going to the dump. Triple A 1, H is 6. H is 9, triple A 0. Exactly. Okay. Confirmed it. So you can convert a floating point, a Boolean, into a floating point. That's what I'm doing here. And then mixing them. Dump tired. No, I'm not. This is Xcode right here. This is Vim here. Okay, so we don't need that. Now we can do hasn't bits can become a floating point pretty easily. So we'll do float has and bits times or minus a half and then times two. Yeah. All that multiplied by u, right? So if that was, if it's less, yeah, if hasn't bits h1, we use one. So hasn't bits h1 would be one if it was correct, and then subtract one becomes 0.5, multiply by two becomes one again. Oh yeah, so all that multiplied by u. Okay, and then this is going to be V times float hasn't bits H2 minus 0.5 times 2. Okay, I need to review this a little bit, and then so this is u times, if you don't have the bit, it should become negative one. And otherwise it becomes one. Yeah, that was good. Space Vim? It's for Vim, basically. Nice. Okay, let's see if this works. First of all, I'm going to run it without any of the profiling on so we can see if the terrain on the ground is exactly the same as it was before. We'll compare it against this picture. Did I delete them? I'm such an idiot. I'm not actually an idiot. Don't believe him. Don't believe the man. Yay, there they are. Okay, so compared to these screenshots, it should look exactly like these. Oh, it changed. I messed something up. Dang, well, it still generated purlin noise though. Yeah, it totally changed it. Oh, I messed it up. Well, I can fix it, but let's see if it actually made it perform faster. And that's gonna be it for today's stream, so give me like 5 more minutes here. I gotta get some dinner soon. Yeah, so we got profile areas back on. Compile, profile. Cross your fingers this is any faster. I hope it is. But it's probably going to be best to just use the meta solution anyways, where there's only one purlin noise. One, two, three, four, five. Still slower. Oh. Oh. All my attempts to make this function faster have not succeeded. Yeah, that's a good sign, yeah. Well, I guess I'm gonna have to throw this whole altless commit away. Or like check it in with some of my thoughts or whatever, but it looks like I failed to make the Perlin Noise class generate any faster by using mix, taking away all its branches. Probably because I'm incurring more function call overhead by calling mixf. Which I could just do a little pound to find just to make sure if that's the thing. Let's see if it is. Let's make a thing called mixf a b alpha. All right, and if we use that function, or that define instead, this could be slower. Okay, last profile. Still slower. Oh man. Can't believe it. We went from Perlin Noise taking about 2.92 seconds to like 3.6 or whatever with this latest one. So it's just slower. By trying to remove these branches, the problem with trying to remove branches is that you have to calculate both values of the branch that you do. So if this were a shader, this might actually make it perform faster, but because it's running on the CPU, it's not, I guess. Maybe I just don't understand about that much about how this is all becoming assembly code anyways. I don't know. I know, right? You would think this would go faster, but profiling reveals it's not. There's absolutely no branches in this code anymore. Yeah, it's probably just that. It's probably just that the CPU is super badass at its branching and all that. Well, even let's do it like this, so I can actually turn this off or on. Oh, Teeks, no, it's not that. It's because I'm doing the same exact time each time. So I always make sure to select a region that's 10 seconds exactly. So it's not based on percentage, it's based on the actual amount of time in 10 seconds. So out of 10 seconds, it took 3.63 seconds to generate purlin noise while it's just constantly generating areas. So no, this is debug mode. This is not no optimizations. Oh, that's true, Salad. Oh, Salad, that's a really good example, a really good point. I should compile this in release mode and try it that. Wait a minute. Does the profile scheme set up that way? Maybe that is. When it goes to pro, oh no, I set it to manually profile in debug mode. But I think by default Xcode does release. But yeah, it is debug mode. I could switch to release mode. I probably should do that actually. Before I call it quits on this whole no branches thing, I probably should do one little Oh, this should be one or a zero. Yeah. I'm going to get some dinner and I'll come back and try that. I'll switch the profiler to make sure it runs in release mode and then try both those things again. In fact, I'll even pull out these two little pound defines so I can easily switch between the two. So I've got not no branches. Let's profile last time just to make sure that it still is back to its old 2.92 around. Yeah, 2.8. There you go. That's the fastest version in debug mode, but we'll see. After I get some dinner, I'll find out if release mode perhaps is faster with those. All right, well, thanks for watching, everybody. Hope you all have a great Great afternoon. What's for dinner? Probably just some rice and beans and other stuff. It's not gonna be super yummy, but at least it'll be dinner. Hope you guys have a nice dinner or evening or whatever is going on for you too. Thanks for watching. We'll see y'all next time. Thanks, man.